The first of them of Frederic Bremacher and then Professor Schubring. Frederic is a friend of us and he works at the University d'Artois, École Polytechnique. Gert is also a friend of us. Nowadays he lives in Brazil and he works at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro. Each of them has 35 minutes and after the talks we have time for questions, comments and so on. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this invitation to this very nice meeting. So, reflecting about Poincaré's méthode nouvelle de la mécanique céleste, it's quite natural to wonder about what's new in these new methods. And so, wondering about that, one can turn to mathematicians, of course, in the 20th century. And of course, there's the issue of the origin of chaos theory in relation to the investigation of dynamical system. But then, there's the issue of what does chaos theory mean? And as has been showed, in details by David Aubin and Ami Daron, chaos theory actually has meant several things in different times and different social times. And these various meanings are related to various readings of Poincaré's Mécanique Céleste, which are focused on different aspects of these three volumes, these three huge volumes. So of course, there's the qualitative investigations of differential equations, the consideration of the variation of a differential system in function of a parameter, the issue of global stability of sets of trajectories of celestial bodies, or the introduction of probabilities into celestial mechanics with the recurrence theorem and so on. But actually, I'm not going to talk about any of these issues, so maybe Alain Chancinet is going to talk about them later. And the aim of my talk, actually, which maybe is a bit weird, is it aims at shedding a new light at some aspects of Poincaré's celestial mechanics by highlighting some issues that actually were hardly new at the time, and also hardly belong to celestial mechanics, at least at first sight. Okay. So we can also turn to Poincaré himself in the way he described what was the novelty of his approach to celestial mechanics. And what is striking is that Poincaré insisted on the role played by linear differential systems with constant coefficients in the investigations of secular inequalities, that is, the small oscillations of planets on the orbits. And he said this is something more related to the new methods than to the old methods, which seems quite paradoxical, given the fact that the use of linear systems in celestial mechanics dates back to the 18th century, of course, with the great works of D'Alembert, Lagrange, Simon Laplace, and so on. And so this claim has to be related to another one, which is the introduction of the first famous memoir sur les courbes définies par les équations différentielles, which, as Alain Cessiner said this morning, is immediately related to celestial mechanics by Poincaré himself, already in 1881. And in introducing his new methods for analyzing differential equations, Poincaré is introducing them in analogy with the role played by Sturm's theorem in algebra. And it says that when you investigate algebraic equations, there are two steps. The first is the qualitative part of the investigation. You have to find out the number of real roots of the equations by appealing to Sturm's theorem. The second is the quantitative part, where you compute the numerical values of the roots. And it says it's the same thing in function theory. There are two parts. We have to start with the qualitative part, which is to look for the curves defined by differential systems and so on. Okay. So as we will see, actually, these two references, the one to Sturm's theorem and the one to linear systems, are very much related one to another, and they both implicitly point to an algebraic dimension of Poincaré's approach, which has been overlooked by the historiography of the méthode nouvelle, but nevertheless plays a key role in the architecture of the strategy developed by Poincaré. So this is what I call the algebraic cast of Poincaré's méthode nouvelle, which I would like to investigate now. And so it provides the opportunity, actually, to look upward to Poincaré's méthode nouvelle, and not to look at this volume backward, retrospectively from the 20th century, the development of the theory of differential systems, and so on and so on. And especially at some of the issues that used to be considered as important at the time of Poincaré, but which have been considered as secondary by various retrospective readings of the 20th century. So I don't know if we are looking at the garbage of Poincaré, as we did this morning, but we maybe are looking at the garbage of mathematicians in the 20th century, mathematicians as readers of Poincaré. So this approach, I think, is important not only for grasping the novelty of Poincaré's method, but also for analyzing the various temporalities and collective dimensions in which Poincaré's works took place, as his works in celestial mechanics is often described as a point of origin of something, with little interest of what was there before. Where does that come from, actually? So also we'll see that this approach sheds a new light on the relationships between celestial mechanics and the other branches of the mathematical sciences in the 19th century. So the first important aspect is the role played by linear systems. We have seen Poincaré's quotation before, and periodic solutions, that is solutions of, for instance, the three-body problems that come back to the initial conditions, for instance, in the architecture of Poincaré's strategy in celestial mechanics. And this importance is recognized by some contemporaries of Poincaré, such as, for instance, Adamard, who highlight the role played by periodic solutions in his eulogy of Poincaré at the time of the death of Poincaré. So I'm not going to talk about the context of Poincaré's works on celestial mechanics, which has been analyzed in detail by June, and also, of course, the issue of the error in Poincaré's memoir, which also have been has triggered quite some work in the history of mathematics, and which prompts a second memoir in response to the prize of Oscar II, which is eventually published, and eventually the writing of the Méthode Nouvelle, starting in 1892, with the first volume, which is the one on which I'm going to focus in this talk. So, just recall that the general approach is to consider a celestial body as a point, which trajectory is expressed in function of the time by some analytical functions, which are the solutions of a differential system, which actually cannot be solved exactly. Okay, that, of course, is the main issue. And so the strategy is to approach the general solutions of these systems by particular ones. So among particular solutions, some, as Poincaré says, are only bizarre. For instance, the moon, the initial conditions of the problems could have been such that the moon would have been always full or always new, and so on. But some of these have some astronomical applications. And this is the case of the periodic solutions, especially investigated by George Hill in his theory of the moon, which I'm not going to talk about, which maybe Tatiana is going to talk about. And one of the reasons why I'm not going to talk about is that Poincaré makes it clear that his aim is not to investigate periodic solutions for themselves. As he said, there is a probability of zero that the initial conditions of the motion would be exactly the ones corresponding to a periodic solution. But it can happen that actually the trajectories are very close to a periodic solution. And so we can take the periodic solution as a first approximation. Okay, so there is a strategy of approximation, and periodic solutions are the first approximation. And this is why these solutions are so precious, is that they are the only bridge by which one can try to storm a fortress that used to be thought as unassailable. Okay. So, as is well known, the investigations of periodic solutions is the basis of the description of more complex trajectories, such as asymptotic solutions and the well-known homoclinic solutions. And I guess that Alain Chancinet is going to talk about the role they play in this connection. But in my talk, I'm more interested in the issue of where the strategy comes from. I mean, the strategy of approximation by using periodic solutions. And I will claim that actually this strategy is molded on a specific approach to the secular inequalities in planetary theory that have been developed in the 18th century. And the aim, Poincaré's aim in investigating these solutions is to introduce linear systems as they have been investigated in the 18th century. So, recall that in the 18th century, the secular inequalities in planetary theory have been investigated on the model of the mathematization that had been given previously to some problems of swinging strings, especially by Jean Le Rond d'Alembert, who described the small oscillations of a string loaded by with two bodies by neglecting the nonlinear terms in the development of the equations of dynamics, and thus by getting a system of two linear equations with constant coefficients. This approach was generalized by Lagrange in 1766 to the case of strings loaded with n bodies. And so one does get a system of n linear equations with constant coefficients. So now the method to integrate this system is based on its decomposition into n independent equations. So where does this method come from? It is itself a mathematization of a mechanical observation that the oscillation of a swinging string can be decomposed into the independent oscillations of n distinct strings, which would each be loaded with a single body, each of them. So this is an observation that is, for instance, given by Bernoulli. So The idea is to find the periodicity of such a proper oscillation of one of these independent strings. So if we call it S, sorry. You can imagine it's just, I don't know if there's some shock. So, of course, they do not make any drawings. So it's my drawing, it's not D'Alembert's drawing. So you imagine you have a string, okay, and you have some bodies on it. And then it's swinging, and it's small oscillations. Okay, the fact that it's small oscillations is, of course, important because it's going to be the connection with celestial mechanics after all. And so if you look for the proper oscillation, that is the ones of the corresponding single strings, okay, the n single strings that would correspond to this, of course, it corresponds to an ion value in a modern parlance. Okay, then you have to solve an equation of sorry? Wait, what did I say? Ah, yes, you're right. Actually, I just copied the first line and then I suppressed the sum, but you're absolutely right. So you have an equation of degree n, which is computed, of course, from the determinant of the system. Okay, and so this equation is called the equation in S. Throughout the 19th century, it's a terminology that Poincaré is still using in his method of celestial mechanics. And so to each root of this equation, you will associate a proper oscillation of the system, of course. And so if the equation has n distinct roots, then you get n independent solutions. From the linear combinations of which, you will get the general solutions of the system. So then one can wonder what happens if you have multiple roots. And this is actually a key issue, and I'm going to go back to it later. So in the 1770s, Lagrange and Laplace have transferred this mathematicization to the investigations of the secular inequalities in planetary theory, that is the small oscillations of planets on their orbits. Okay, and from this point on, this equation in S, which plays such a key role in this approach, has also been named the equation to the secular inequalities in planetary theory, which I will say the secular equation for short. So now let's go back to Poincaré. So of course Poincaré, as we have seen, doesn't consider directly linear differential system with constant coefficient. But his strategy of approximation by periodic trajectories is nevertheless molded on Lagrange's method, as it aims at introducing linear systems. So for instance, if you consider a given periodic solution, you add a small variation, and the notation is exactly the same as the one used by Lagrange for the small oscillations of a string, for instance. Then you get another trajectory. And then if you replace this expression, this one, in the equations of the system, sorry, then you get what Poincaré calls the variations equations, which express the difference between the two trajectories. Now, if you suppose that this difference is very small, you can neglect all the terms of a degree higher than the first, and you get a linear differential system whose coefficients are not constant, but are periodic functions of the time, say of period 2 pi. And now, if you look at this system, because of the linearity, you can find a basis of solution. That is, a solution is a linear combination of n independent solutions. Now, because of the periodicity, if you add 2 pi to the time, then you still have a solution. Then one of these independent solutions plus 2 pi is still a solution. So it can be expressed as a linear combination of the n independent solutions. And so eventually, you get a linear system, this time with constant coefficient, so that you can use Lagrange's method. Okay. And so eventually, in Poincaré's approach, the small variation of a periodic trajectory is mathematized by a linear system with constant coefficients. So again, you compute the equation in S, and you express the difference between the two trajectories in a very similar way as the one used by Lagrange, except that this time you also have convergent trigonometric sums in addition to the constant and also the trigonometric or exponential proper oscillations. Now, of course, these coefficients, the roots of the equation in S, play a key role in this whole approach. And Poincaré calls them the characteristic exponents. And so they mix some mechanical and algebraic significations, which are not the same in Lagrange and Poincaré's approach, of course. Recall that in Lagrange's approach, there was a mechanical representation of the roots as the periods of proper oscillations of, for instance, string, okay, or the elliptic orbits of the planet. Whereas in Poincaré's approach, the proper oscillations are oscillations not of the elliptic orbit of the planet, but in general of a periodic trajectory. And so the associations generate a set of other trajectories in its neighborhood. And so the behavior of this set of trajectories is then controlled by the algebraic nature of the characteristic exponents, and especially by the order of multiplicity of the roots of the equation in S, as we will see later with this key issue of multiple roots or not. So then you get the issue of stability, which is a first step in the analysis of the flows of trajectories in the neighborhood of a periodic solution. So as is well known, Poincaré comes to some conclusions, such as if the periodic solution remains stable, then the approach trajectory will remain close to the periodic solution. Otherwise, unstable periodic solutions support the introductions of more complex trajectories, such as the Mauchlinic solutions or asymptotic solutions. But then what does the stability of a periodic solution mean, of course? So there is various notions of stability in Poincaré's works, as has been analyzed recently in details by Tatiana, and I will only focus on what he calls the stability of a periodic trajectory in the sense of Lagrange. So in the 18th century, a criterion was given by D'Alembert, Lagrange, Laplace, and so on, for the mechanical stability in function of the algebraic nature of the roots of the equation in S, which is that the mechanical system is stable if and only if the roots are real, negatives, and distinct. So why? Because in this situation, then a particular solution of the differential system is going to be a trigonometric function. Okay, so it remains bounded. Whereas if you have imaginary roots, then you will get some exponential oscillations. And it was believed that in the case of multiple roots, and in this case, actually, the method doesn't work anymore because you need to have n distinct solutions, then the time gets out of the trigonometric function, and so it creates unbounded oscillations again. So this is actually false. It was proved by Weierstrass and Jordan much later. So this kind of expressions where the time gets out of the trigonometric functions was called a secular term in the case of celestial mechanics. And in the 18th century, most of the discussions on the issue of the stability of the solar system revolved around the question of, do we have secular terms or not? Can we remove them? And especially Laplace proof involved proving that the roots of the equation in S are real, negatives, and distinct to get rid of these secular terms. Now, in the 19th century, the nonlinear terms in the developments of the equation subdynamics have been considered, taken into account, beginning with Poisson's work and, of course, Le Verrier. And this has been analyzed, for instance, by Jacques Lascar. And various theories have been introduced by astronomers in the aim to rule out all secular terms. And so the notion of stability has been associated to the possibility of getting strictly periodic series development whose first term decreases fast, which is a conception of the astronomical convergence of series, which is actually different from the mathematical notion of the convergence of a series. So as is well known, Poincaré proved that the series used by the astronomers were actually divergent, mathematically speaking. So his approach to stability is then different from the one of the most of the works of the 19th century, because actually he came back to the linear case, to the 18th century, and to the investigation of the roots of the equation in S, that is the characteristic exponents, as he called them, and he calls them also coefficients of stability. Now, if you look at Poincaré's criterion in the sense of Lagrange, it's exactly the same, word for word, as the one of Lagrange in the 18th century. But this time, it's not the stability of the solar system in itself, but it's the stability of a periodic trajectory. That is, if the roots are real, negatives, and distinct, then the system is stable, otherwise it's not. So coming back to this issue of something that is hardly new, now we can understand better Poincaré's claim to go back to linear differential systems with constant coefficients that were used in the 18th century. So there is the idea that the new methods he's developing are cast out the ancient methods from the 18th century. So there is also the claim to jump over all the 19th century to go back to Lagrange and Laplace and so on in a direct relationship. Okay. And actually in the historiography, Poincaré's meta-nouvelle have very often been presented as the first treatise to reopen the issue of the stability of the solar system after Laplace's work in the end of the 18th century. Yet, even though stability of the solar system may have often been taken for granted after Laplace's proof, Lagrange's methods, which appeal to linear systems with constant coefficients and so on, in celestial mechanics have nevertheless been developed by many mathematicians working in various domains throughout the 19th century. And of course, Poincaré is appealing to these developments of Lagrange's approach to linear systems. And so he's not reading directly Lagrange, but he's reading Lagrange through the filter of all these developments by mathematicians, for instance, such as Cauchy, Hermite, Jordan, and so on. So up to now, we have been analyzing Poincaré in a direct relationship to Lagrange, great treatise at the end of the 18th century. So we now have to change the scale of analysis to understand a bit better where this method related to linear systems come from. So during the long run of the 19th century, there are great many references to the secular equations. But most of the time, from authors who have little interest in celestial mechanics. And actually, these references to this equation to the secular inequalities in planetary theory are used to identify an organization of knowledge that played, in the 19th century, the role of a shared algebraic culture. So for instance, you can represent the relationships between some of the texts by a kind of network of texts. Most of these texts are actually entitled on the equation to the secular inequalities in planetary theory. They are related one to another, they cite each other, all of them cite Lagrange, but they are dealing with different topics, so dynamics, celestial mechanics, of course, but also differential equations, analytical geometry, group theory, binomial forms, quadratic forms, and so on. So this reference to the equation to the secular inequalities and so on, it's not a theory, it's not a discipline. It's a kind of algebraic culture which has a few characteristics. The first is the use of Lagrange procedures related to linear systems. The second is a specific ideal of generality, that is to deal with systems of n equations in this specific case. And Poincaré is doing it also, even though he's interested in the three-body problem. Okay? The third is the special nature of the secular equation. It's an equation of degree n because of its generality, so it cannot be solved in general by radical. Most of the time, it's not even expressed as a polynomial form, okay? But you can prove that its roots are real by appealing to the symmetry of the linear systems that generate this equation. So the special nature of this equation has supported various analogies between different branches of the mathematical sciences during the 19th century. So now if we go back to Poincaré, on the one hand, the role played by a specific approach to linear system has to be analyzed in the framework of this shared algebraic culture, which played a very important role in the 19th century. And this is exemplified by the role played by the issue of the nature of the roots of the equation in S in Poincaré's discussions on the existence or the stability of periodic solutions. For instance, you have statements like that. The periodic solutions of the three-body problem have two characteristic exponents equal to zero, and only two, okay? So you have a great many sentences or statements about the existence or the stability of periodic solutions, which are based on the discussion on the algebraic nature of the roots, which is very typical of this algebraic culture related to the secular equation. Now, on the other hand, Poincaré has also developed a specific approach by appealing to two distinct lines of development related to the secular equations and which have developed after the 1850s. One is Hermite's approach to algebraic forms, and the other one is Jordan's approach to substitution theory, that is finite group theory, we would say, nowadays, and especially Jordan's canonical form theorem. So I can only allude to Jordan's legacy, because it's a bit tricky, I don't have the time to talk about it, but the appropriation by Poincaré of Jordan's method in group theory can be followed in the development of the theory of function functions in the beginning of the 1880s, and it plays a key role in the elaboration by Poincaré of specific algebraic methods that he is then using all the time. I'm just alluding to this, and actually this is legitimate in this talk because Poincaré himself only alludes to Jordan's legacy in his celestial mechanics, and he simplifies his own algebraic methods. For instance, when he forms the equation in S, he says, now we have to use the theory of substitutions to do this. But he's not going to make explicit how you do it, and what is the problem behind the... It remains in the kitchen of the celestial mechanics, which is interesting in itself because Poincaré is deciding not to make this explicit when he's addressing a public which is maybe not the same as the one of the theory of function functions and so on. Now, I'm just going to dig deeper now into Hermite's legacy and into the problem raised by the multiplicity of the roots of the secular equation. So, It's customary today to, when you think about a linear system and you want to integrate it, to extract a matrix from it and then to manipulate the matrix with the lines and the columns and so on. But Lagrange's method, the method to which I've been alluded several times, is different. It's a polynomial method that gives polynomial expressions of what we would say the ion vectors related to an ion value. So as a quotient of two polynomials, one is computed from the characteristic determinant of the system, that is the determinant of the system A minus the unknown times the identity matrix, and the others are its successive minors. Okay. Then you can make these quotients, and if you replace the unknown by the roots of the circular equations, then you will get the coordinates of the, what we would say, the ion vectors. So, in modern parlance, actually, this method is tantamount to computing the matrix of cofactor of the characteristic matrix, and you will get the coordinates of the ion vectors in the non-zero column of this matrix. So it gives you a polynomial expression of the ion vectors of a symmetric matrix. Okay. Now, I've been alluding to the fact that this method, Lagrange method, has been circulating in the 19th century in various branches of the mathematical sciences. So this is what Cauchy is doing about it. So Cauchy is writing a paper on the equation to the circular inequalities in planetary theory in 1829, even though his interest is in geometry, is the problem of finding the principal axis of a conic or of a quadric in analytical geometry. Okay, but then you get an homogeneous function, and the issue is to write this function to change the basis, to write this function as a sum of square. Okay? And so Cauchy says for doing this, you have to compute an equation from a determinant, which is actually analogous to the circular equations, because its roots are real, there's a determinant, and so on. And so he's using Lagrange's method and to compute this sum of squares. Okay? And the coefficients in the sum of squares are given themselves by the quotients of the successive minors extracted from the characteristic determinant. That is the equation in S. Now, of course, in both this expression, that is the expression you have to use to change the basis in analytical geometry. And in this expression, the sum of square, if you have multiple roots in the equation in S, then you are in trouble, because then you can have a common root between a minor and between the characteristic equation. So you can have zero on zero. So it doesn't mean anything anymore. So Cauchy, of course, was very well aware of this problem, which actually is a very serious problem, and quite similar to the one of what does the root of a negative number means, which triggered the development of complex analysis. And actually, Cauchy's residue theory was developed partly to solve the problem of the multiplicity of the roots of the circular equation. So after Cauchy's work in complex analysis to solve this problem, in the 1850s, different algebraic approaches to this problem have been developed. One by Hermite in the algebraic theory of quadratic form, one by Weierstrass in relation to what is elementary divisor theorem, and one by Jordan with his canonical form in finite group theory. So actually, these different lines of development with, on what used to be a shared algebraic culture before explain a lot about what is happening at the end of the 19th century, and especially they gave a strong structuration of the algebraic methods that were used at the end of the 19th century. For instance, it's quite usual to compare Klein to Poincaré. Klein is always using Weierstrass elementary divisors, Poincaré never. Poincaré is always using Jordan's canonical form and Hermite's algebraic theory of quadratic forms, Klein never. Okay. So now let's look further at Hermite's approach to these issues. In the 1850s, Hermite and Sylvester have looked for a purely algebraic proof of Sturm theorem. So this is where we're going to see now the connection of this approach by linear systems and Sturm theorem that we have seen in Poincaré's quotations at the beginning. By the investigation of the specific case of the circular equation, because the circular equation is an equation which has real roots. This is known. The issue is how many? I mean, do you have multiple roots and this kind of thing? So you can investigate this equation in the aim to investigate more generally the issue of the number of real roots of an equation. So to the circular equation, one can associate a quadratic form. And this quadratic form can be transformed into a sum of squares. Now the number of, so of course this is not unique, okay, this expression is not unique, but the number of positive and negative signs is an invariant of the quadratic form, which is known nowadays as Sylvester's inertial law. But more importantly, this invariant provides the number of real distinct roots of the secular equation. And more generally, actually, it gives a proof of Sturm theorem. So by expressing this sum of squares, you have the number of real roots of the secular equation and distinct roots. Okay. So in the context of the development of Hermite's theory of algebraic forms, which I cannot, of course, I cannot go into this into details, this approach gave rise to a new definition of the notion of multiple roots itself, which is that you consider an algebraic equation, then you associate a quadratic form to it, then you compute a determinant, and then you look for all the minors of the characteristic determinant, which do not vanish, and it gives you the order of multiplicity of the root. Okay, so it's... Okay, sure, perfect. Now, for the mathematicians working in Hermite's legacy, such as, for instance, Darboux or Poincaré or many others, this definition is taken again and is taken again and again. So, for instance, this is an example of a quotation from Darboux's approach to the theory of quadratic forms, and this is an example from Poincaré's celestial mechanics. It's almost the same statement. Okay? It's based on this definition, specific definition of the notion of multiple root. But now what Poincaré is doing in his celestial mechanics is that he transfers this definition from algebraic equations to differential equations, and is appealing to this definition to define the multiplicity of periodic trajectories. Now, recall that we have seen that periodic solutions, they aim at supporting a method of approximations, okay, of the trajectories in celestial mechanics. So there are actually two methods of approximations. The method of variations, in which you investigate sets of solutions of the same differential system, and the method of perturbation, in which you investigate actually differential systems in functions of a parameter. So I'm going to go fast on this. And so Hermite's approach, and especially this definition of the multiplicity of roots, supports the analysis of the variation of the number of distinct roots of an algebraic equation, especially the equation in S. So this is especially clear, for instance, in Darboux's approach, who says the number of square roots in Sylvester's inertial law can only change if the unknown of the equation passes through a root of the equation. And in that case, the number of square roots can only vary from a magnitude superior, higher than the order of multiplicity of the root considered. Now, if you look at Poincaré's celestial mechanics, in the case of the perturbation of periodic trajectories, I must observe that a periodic solution can only disappear when the parameter mu goes from a negative to a positive value. If for mu equal to zero, then the equation has a multiple root. It means then the secular equation. In other terms, a periodic solution can only disappear after it has been equal with another periodic solution with which it has exchanged its stability. So periodic solutions disappear by pairs, similarly as the roots of algebraic equations. So you have a great many of statements like that in Poincaré's celestial mechanics. So there is a kind of algebraic mold from which Poincaré casts out the analysis of the perturbations of periodic solutions in function of the parameter mu. So, of course, there are other stations like that, but maybe I can go a bit faster. So, to conclude, we are used to looking backward at Poincaré's celestial mechanics and to celebrate, for instance, a starting point of chaos theory in relation to the investigations of dynamical systems and so on. But we can also look upward to Poincaré's celestial mechanics and see that there's a strategy that can also be analyzed as molded on or casted out some specific algebraic practices for manipulating systems of linear equations. So, of course, it's a very specific aspect of Poincaré's celestial mechanics. It's not the aim of the celestial mechanics itself, but it says a lot about the strategy that Poincaré is developing. It's similar to, metaphorically speaking, to the structure of a cast iron building, for instance. It may be less noticeable than the creative facade, okay, that's what is built in the end. And similarly, the algebraic cast of Poincaré's strategy is broken out of the mold in generating the new methods, which are not algebraic anymore, of course, in the end. Which this maybe is a bit similar to what Catherine was talking about this morning. Moreover, these various components that are mixed up in this in making this new method, they can be used to trace the collective dimensions of Poincaré's work. So we have seen actually different scales of the collective dimensions in which Poincaré's work takes place. First, in the long run, and at the European scale, the shared algebraic culture of the equation to the secular inequalities and so on, with specific practices attached to linear systems, which can be used to understand Poincaré's strategy related to periodic solutions, which are used to introduce linear systems, and then to use Lagrange procedures and so on. And at a smaller case, Hermite's legacy in the theory of algebraic form, with a specific definition of the notion of multiple roots, to which Poincaré is appealing to analyze the variations of the perturbations of periodic solutions. Now, coming back to the issue of the relationships between celestial mechanics and other branches of the mathematical sciences in the 19th century. So we have seen that this relationship is much more complex than a back and forth motion between applications and abstraction. We have seen that some algebraic procedures related to linear systems, which have played a key role in the 19th century, they emerged from some mechanical works in the 18th century. But moreover, the secular equations was still the basis of a shared algebraic culture throughout the 19th century. It was by appealing to the secular equation, that is to celestial mechanics, that this procedure circulated between analysis, arithmetic, geometry, and so on, thereby enriching these procedures of new significations all the time, before Poincaré used them again in celestial mechanics after a century. So this is actually, in a way, some quite similar to the way Poincaré is describing the complexity of the solutions of differential systems, is some trajectories may recede from the initial conditions, that is here the domain of celestial mechanics, but nevertheless come back to the neighborhood over a long time. So maybe if I still have 1 minute, I don't know, okay? So just to finish, some open questions. So in this talk, I have been shedding light on some specific aspects of Poincaré's méthode nouvelle, and especially on the collective dimensions and the temporalities of these methods, how they are developed and so on. Now, there are some open questions, because this algebraic cast sheds light on some other crucial aspects of Poincaré's méthode nouvelle, which I didn't have the time to talk about, such as the famous surface abstraction method, which has been celebrated for its results on the stability of the solar system, or its non-result on the stability, for the starting point of chaos theory and so on. But yet, if you look at what Poincaré is doing with this surface section method, it's molded on the same algebraic cast. There is an issue of iteration of a transformation in the sixth plane. And for doing this, Poincaré is appealing to a linear approximation. Then linear system with constant coefficient, computation of the equation in S, discussion on the algebraic nature of the roots, which is exactly the same as the one related to the stability of the periodic trajectories. For instance, if the roots are real, positive, and distinct, such that one is greater than one and the other less than one, then there exist two invariant curves in the section planes. So this is the kind of statement that Poincaré is making. So, of course, to understand where this method of section comes from, we can look at various things. We can look at celestial mechanics, geometry, topology, probabilities, and so on. And of course, we can think about Newton's method for approximating algebraic roots by graphical iteration, okay, because it's very similar. But now, what's interesting is that this method actually had been connected by Edmond Laguerre in the 1870s to Hermite's approach to Sturm theorem. That is exactly the starting point of Poincaré's approach to the qualitative approach to differential equations. Moreover, Laguerre's aim, was to generalize this approach to differential equation, which is exactly what Poincaré is doing in his celestial mechanics. And Poincaré celebrates Laguerre exactly for this in his eulogy of Laguerre of 1897. To finish with this, there were a number, number of works connected to Laguerre's approach in France in the 1880s, especially on the issue of the generalization of Sturm's theorem and Newton's method of iteration to differential system, which is exactly Poincaré's program in the celestial mechanics. So I think that to understand better where this celestial mechanics come from, there's still a lot of work to do to understand better the collective dimensions of mathematics in the 1870s, 1880s, and especially many authors, many works that have never been investigated by historians of mathematics, and which have issues which are very similar to the ones tackled by Poincaré. So thank you for your attention.
questions after the
okay.
Gert's talk. Thank you very much, Frederic.
So I'm not sure where, how to make it full screen because I'm never. Oh, so maybe you can.
Oh.
So it must be there somewhere.
No, that was.
So maybe you can just do this.
No,
it's not the right file.
Perspective of Weierstrass and include for this discussion some archival findings. Poincaré is particularly well known for his contribution on the n-body problem and restriction to the three-body version due to the international prize competition, which was organized by the Swedish mathematician Gustav Mittag-Leffler and which should honor the 60th anniversary of Oscar II, King of Sweden and Norway, in January 89. A letter of Mittag-Leffler of June 84 to Sofia Kovalevskaya shows a competition already being prepared, discussing with her possible members of the jury. Due to an evident arithmetic for such juries, it could be just a member from each country, and given the early choice of Weierstrass, there was no way to call Kronecker. A letter from Weierstrass to Mittag-Leffler of 8 March 1883 shows, however, that they were discussing already then possible subjects for the prize competition. In fact, Weierstrass was presenting there what he had already researched about that topic, which should become the subject tackled by Poincaré. Since when and why Weierstrass was interested in the n-body problem? Mittag-Leffler, who had published in 1912 a series of documents on the prize competition as a contribution to Weierstrass' biography, evidenced an intense cooperation with occupation with the problem already since the early 1870s. In fact, a letter of 16 December 1870 for to his student and friend Sofia Kovalevskaya, Weierstrass remembered how they had reflected doing mathematical dreams about this problem since they became closer friends. And so since about 1872, they were dreaming to solve and to find the conditions for the stability of the Weltsystem, of the system of the universe. In that letter of 1874, Weierstrass exposed progress he had achieved on treating the implied differential equations. In the subsequent years, he returned various times in his correspondence with her to the problem and reported of various progress achieved, striving to prove the convergence of theories obtained. Eventually, in March 1881, he reported that he had given an exposition in the seminar run by him for advanced mathematics students and told that he had made some progress but still saw too many problems to really overcome the obstacles and that he was now convinced that one needed to know entirely new approaches. Letters of 1882 show that both had become aware that Poincaré was working on related questions regarding the integration of differential equations of mechanics. Sophia, in a letter of June 1882, reported to Weierstrass that she at first had come about this first paper by Poincaré, the first one of the series of four papers. And only later on, in July, actually it was Poincaré himself who sent to Weierstrass the first one of these four papers just published, and Poincaré presented himself here as an admirer of the work of Weierstrass. From now on, Weierstrass reported to Sophia much more concretely what he had lectured in these seminar sessions, already proving theorems that the coordinates of the moving points the coordinates of the moving points in the system are analytic functions. In fact, these seminar lectures, these seminar lectures apparently attracted immediately an enormous interest, as it was already customary with his lectures. Students had taken notes of these seminar lectures, these seminar sessions too, and copies of them were circulating. One reader of them was Hugo Gilden, a colleague of Mittag Leffler, and Weierstrass explained in his letter to Mittag Leffler of 8 March 1883, where the price question on the n-body problem was apparently almost decided, misunderstandings of Gulden regarding these notes and the entire problem, and thus showed to Mittag Leffler that the price question should be solvable. Here too, Weierstrass mentioned related relevant research of Poincaré. So Poincaré hence pursued in a parallel manner to his intense competition with Felix Klein on function theoretic issues, which Gerard Grimberg will analyze here on Thursday. It is obvious that Weierstrass must have sought at Poincaré as a potential competitor for the prize. A letter of 7 August 1885 from Weierstrass to Mittag Leffler proves to be a decisive document in various respects. It was written after the publication of the prize competition in July 1885 in various journals. Actually, it had also been sent by letters to an enormous number of mathematicians, which caused the anger of Kronecker in particular. There had also already occurred the first conflict with Kronecker on the competition. Besides Kronecker, the prize question on the n-body problem had provoked the discontent of several astronomers upset about the demand to apply the modern methods of function theory. Actually, Poincaré suffered analogous misgivings by astronomers, in particular when he showed that Lindstein's claim of the series being convergent was wrong. It is in this letter of 1885 that Weierstrass revealed his key motivation for occupying himself with the n-body problem, and I call this his vision. He criticized the astronomers to have neglected their principal duty to investigate the construction of the system du monde, of the Weltsystem, to reveal the fundamental law assuring the stability of the universe. So emphasizing it should be one such fundamental law. We understand thus now a hitherto not reflected dimension of Weierstrass as a scientist, although having appeared to us as a researcher completely dedicated to mathematics in a calm and down-to-earth manner, striving for utmost rigor within mathematics, there's a deeper underlying dimension, profoundly concerned with achieving a physical, philosophical understanding of the universe. His firm conviction is that of a harmony, of a stability of the universe. Thus, research in mathematics reveals to be not an end in itself for him, but an essential confrontation for essential contribution for detecting this unique fundamental law, which must assure the aspired stability. On the other hand, this letter provides what Weierstrass later claims to be the proof of the solvability of the price question. In fact, it is again those seminar lectures of the winter term 1880-1881, which he now exposes in remarkable detail and much less skeptical than before in his letter to Sophia. And in remarkable length too. So in the printed version in the Acta of 1912, these are 10 pages, and thus it might have been 30 manuscript pages. A short expert excerpt I'm showing here, well, this is his report to Mitta Kleffler on this seminar of winter term 1880-1881 on perturbations in astronomy. And this is a short excerpt to show the beginning of his discussion. It was in fact within the same context that Kronecker entered into the evolution of the prize competition, erecting more serious obstacles than the astronomers. Having received the announcement, which came to him as a total surprise, he sent the 29 July a letter to Mitta Kleffler full of aggressivity. This letter had not been localized in the Mitta Kleffler Institute by June, but upon her research, but it exists there in fact. And here you see the first page of this letter, and for easier understanding, transcription of the first page. Kronecker's principal accusation was to have been totally misled by Mitta Kleffler. While Mitta Kleffler used to present himself as a friend and as an admirer, seeking advice in many respects, he had in reality misled Kronecker, since he had hided the preparation of the competition from him, and in particular excluded him from the committee. If Mitta Kleffler's relation with him were in fact as friendly as maintained, he would have had to call him at the same time as Hermite and Weierstrass. Actually, he would have been the first one to be commissioned, since there exists no better expert in the world than himself. So, actually presented himself in this letter as a world-leading expert in research on algebra, and even doubted the competence of the three jury members, mentioning in particular that question number 4, composed by Hermite with Poincaré II as potential author, was proved by him some 25 years ago to be unsolvable. The letter ended with the announcement he would contact directly King Oscar II and explain him who is a real expert in algebra. In his answer, Mitta Kleffler hastened to argue along the disciplinary line which Kronecker seemed to have provided. Given the difficult task to explain why Kronecker had not been commissioned, the argument was, using Kronecker's own words, that the prize questions were not on algebra, but on higher analysis, and in particular on function theory, and there especially on analytic functions in the sense of Weierstrass. This proved not to be a convincing line of argumentation for Kronecker, since his answer of 16 August 1885 showed that in his vision of mathematics, analysis is but a branch of algebra, and higher analysis evidently too. Moreover, Mitta Kleffler's disciplinary delimitation of expertise made Kronecker now attack Weierstrass directly, no longer just question number 4 related to Hermite. Kronecker claimed now to be competent for question number 1-2, since the friend mentioned in the question, to whom Dirichlet had revealed his last findings, was he, Kronecker himself. As in fact proved by Kummer's obituary speech on Dirichlet, which was a source for Weierstrass' inspiration. although not questioning here the legitimacy of the demand to find those theories, Kronecker ridiculed it, given that Dirichlet could not have reduced analytic functions in the sense of Weierstrass. Transposing to Dirichlet his own avoidance of the infinite, Kronecker claimed that the prize question, maintaining to revive Dirichlet's achievements, should not have prescribed the use of series and of analytic functions. This was the occasion for Kronecker to claim that the functions of various variables developed by him were more general than functions of complex variables, alluding thus to his module functions. According to Biermann in his entry in the Dictionary of Scientific Biography, the tensions between Weierstrass and Kronecker dated already since the 1870s. But my evaluation of Kronecker's correspondence with Weierstrass, which I detected some time ago, did not confirm this. The true outbreak dates of 1883, when Kronecker, then editor of Quelle's journal, stopped the printing of a paper by Weierstrass and claimed priority for its contents, even calling Weierstrass to be his disciple. And Weierstrass and Mittag-Leffler, and Weierstrass told Mittag-Leffler in 1888 that now their discord had become complete and definitive. In fact, what Kronecker had dared to do exceeds by far what might be quarrels among colleagues. He had not addressed King Oscar II, as announced, but on 12 April 1888, he read a paper at the Berlin Academy, which presented to be a report on Dirichlet's last works, but which in reality was an accusation that the question number one of the Swedish prize competition formulated by Weierstrass was unfounded. After quoting the passage on Dirichlet's last works from Kummer's obituary, Kronecker quoted completely prized question number one from Acta Mathematica without ever speaking explicitly of Weierstrass, and continued to expose that the formulation stood in outright contradiction to Kummer's report and moreover to what Kronecker now related in more detail. That the prize question had joined together two assertions which Kummer had told as constituting two different subjects, and which Kronecker now reported to have been told by Dirichlet at two different days and without apparent connection. Thus the assertion on the one hand that Dirichlet had mentioned to have found a proof for the stability of the universe, and secondly his communication to have detected a new general method for treating and solving the problems of mechanics. It constituted Kronecker's special and preferred concern and even pleasure to attribute to Dirichlet to have revealed to him, Kronecker, that his new method was not based on series, but on a type of recursive procedure, thus to be an implicit recusation of Weierstrass methods. Yes, in fact, Kronecker put in Dirichlet's mouth to have meant by this to not basing himself on series in the sense of developing functions, that is, of having rejected Weierstrass' approach. Whereas Weierstrass, in his reaction to Mittag-Leffler upon Mittag-Leffler's question, Weierstrass reacted and explained that Kronecker's arguments were not decisive and that for him it was a legitimate understanding to see both statements of Dirichlet being related and not to be independent. Internal as well as external reasons made for him a connection more than probable. Besides a minor error, in the formulation chronicles new, more detailed report on his conversations with Dirichlet afforded no change at all in the prize formulation. Weierstrass was announced he would send a carefully weighed answer to the Academy. In later letters, Weierstrass saw, however, more disadvantages than positive outcomes of such an explicit reaction. In fact, his attention was by now more taken by the analysis of Poincaré's dissertation. Some points in it were not well understandable, and thus Mittag-Leffler, contrary to the norms of for such prize competitions, began to communicate with Poincaré to ask him explanations of obscure passages. In the end, there resulted a series of additional notes named from A to I, augmenting the original manuscript by 90 pages. It is revealing that among the Nachlass, which Weierstrass had kept himself and not destroyed, as almost all other documents, there's one of Poincaré's letters of this period. At first, detecting this French text among the collection of what had been arranged by some archivists as letters by Italians had at first caused me some headache. Apparently, this text being a fragment. The content of the letter, speaking of conditions for stability and discussing work by Bolin, clearly hinted to Poincaré. In fact, it proved to be Poincaré's letter of 15 January 1889 to Mittag-Leffler. This letter is available in transcription in the Poincaré archives at Nancy, so the 5 pages of the written version are 2 pages in this transcription. The handwriting of the manuscript in Weierstrass' Nachlass is neither by Poincaré, nor by Weierstrass, nor by Mittag-Leffler. It seems to be by Fragment. Thus, Mittag-Leffler had asked maybe Fragment to make a copy for Weierstrass, and Weierstrass, although not keeping other documents of this entire topic, preserved just this letter, which discusses in particular those aspects which he had since a long time researched himself. So on the one hand, discussing the stability of the system, and Poincaré discussing in this letter conditions for the general n-body problem, not just for the restricted three-body problem, which he had chosen for the prize essay. Especially, Poincaré underlined 2 conditions for the stability, which Weierstrass had always stressed, that the distance between 2 bodies cannot become too big, but also not too small. Based on these more general arguments, Poincaré explained why earlier publications by Bolin and by Hill were not relevant for his studies. Thus, there was no priority for Bolin, as Weierstrass had feared. Weierstrass had been charged by the prize committee to write the report assessing the achievements of the winning essay. While he achieved to compose its general part, which served for informing the king and allowing him to confer the prize, Weierstrass became always more hesitant to write the specific part explaining the mathematical achievements of the essay with regard to the original prize question. It were not only growing doubts about various parts of Poincaré's essay which developed composing that text. This period proved to be the same one where Eduard Fragment, a Swedish mathematician and co-editor of Acta Mathematica, detected a serious error in Poincaré's submission and where intense work was undertaken to correct the error and to hide the news of the error. Consequently, Mittag-Leffler no longer pressured Weierstrass so much to finish his report. As a matter of fact, also due to his bad health, Weierstrass never finished his report. Yet, Weierstrass once tried to make his viewpoint on the entire problematic publicly known. It was a letter written in 1891 to Georg Cantor, a letter which seems to be not well known. Weierstrass sent this letter as a reaction to a telegram which Cantor had transmitted to him from the participants of the first annual meeting of the Deutsche Mathematikervereinigung. And Georg Cantor and his friends had invested major efforts to integrate the Berlin mathematicians into this new society. The Berlin group used to be hesitant regarding these activities, suspecting that the Klebsch-Klein group would try to outmaneuver them. Cantor, relatively neutral, had taken over the activities for founding the association, the society, and had invited both Kronecker and Weierstrass to participate and to become members. Kronecker had accepted to deliver a talk at this first meeting, but was not able to come due to the sudden death of his wife shortly before. And Weierstrass had not been able to accept due to his weak health. Thus, the participants at this meeting in Halle from 22 to 26 September had sent him a telegram honoring his work. Weierstrass wished to answer by some sort of paper, and since it did not fit into a telegram, he decided to write a letter to Cantor. And since this would arrive only by the end of the meeting, Weierstrass proposed that Cantor should make this letter known to as many colleagues as possible. Written the 26th September, it arrived in Halle when the participants were already leaving. I have no evidence that Cantor communicated the letter widely. Actually, he published it only in 1905. And then, far away, in the Rendiconti del Circolo Matematico di Palermo, but one can admit that it had a wide international dissemination. Cantor had been prompted to publish it by the Third International Congress of Mathematicians held in 1904 at Heidelberg, where Mittag-Leffler had reminded of his search for biographical documents on Weierstrass. So, the answer, or let's say the substitute for a talk given by which Weierstrass would have liked to give at this first meeting is that the essential point is that he tells that in the last time there had been various reports on the price essay of Poincaré, and that the most detailed one was by Noether, and that in several of these reports there were principal errors told, and that he would have been the primary obligation to describe and correct these errors. So the interesting point is already that since the publication of the prize essay in December 1819 until September of 91, so within 8 months, there had been already several reports published on the prize essay. And so it is not the report which June tells in her book, since this assessment by Minkowski was published in the Jahrbuch in 1893. So already in the first 8 months there had been published several reports, and unfortunately until now I have not been able to locate any of them, and even the report which should be not an erroneous one, since it is mentioned here explicitly by Max Noether, I have not been able to locate until now. But the principal error in various of these reports is to again maintain that the question was not solvable. And so one can think that a greater part of these reports was written by astronomers or by Kronecker friends. Fine, yes. So, the main point in the letter written by Weierstrass to Cantor and so to the German mathematicians is to affirm that the problem is solvable and that Kronecker is not right in his interpretation of Dirichlet's last revealings. And he indicates his own achievements on the way to solving the problem and tells here of letters which he had written to Hermite and to Mittag-Leffler. The text to Hermite seems not to have been preserved, but the letter to Mittag-Leffler is just that one which I had mentioned, the long letter, the enormously long letter of maybe 30 manuscript pages of 1885. And well, he this time Weierstrass did not hesitate to speak of a key error of Kronecker and to say that yes, the main error is not to distinguish whether a variable can admit a value or whether it can approach sufficiently near, and to know that such a distinction is necessary, that one will not detect it who has not the right concept of an irrational number quantity. So this is a direct polemic this time by him regarding Kronecker. So in his conclusion, Weierstrass in this letter expressed his great regret that his forces did not enable him to give a talk personally at the meeting of the Deutsche Mathematische Vereinigung. So the question, finishing question, is what were the results for him regarding the vision which he had? And in fact, in his general report, he expressed that the winning essay just gave a very restricted solution and no solution of that general question which was at his heart, which he would have liked to see to have solved. And besides this, one has to note that ironically it was really the paper by Poincaré, which is one of the origins of the chaos theory, and so just of a very different vision of understanding the universe. So, as a very last point, I have a surprise for you, a very recent finding. And you see, until now, one had just two versions of the text of Poincaré. The first one is the printed version of 1889 with the error, 256 pages, which according to the efforts of Mittag-Leffler was completely destroyed except of two copies which are still extant in the Mittag-Leffler Institute, and besides, evidently one has the corrected published version in the ACTA of 1890. Besides these two, say, print versions, one has a manuscript version also at the Mittag-Leffler Institute. It is Poincaré's manuscript of his corrected version. It is a mix of handwritten sheets and of corrected pages from the first printed version. But now the original manuscript turned up of 17 May 1888, which originally had 189 pages, and which thereafter became enlarged by first 20 pages of notes and eventually 72 pages. And well, how was it possible to turn up? It had disappeared in the time already of Mittag Leffler. It was no longer in his hands, and it was donated now, less than 2 weeks ago, by some descendant of persons who had come into the possession of the manuscript in a way where one might think of Criminal Minds. And it has been donated less than 2 weeks ago to the Mittag Leffler Institute, so returning to the right place. And the guess which the, no, one knows in whose hands the manuscript was all these times. It was in the hands of Swedish astronomers, which usually used to be opposed to Mittag Leffler. And well, this manuscript is seems to it's in handwriting, but not in Poincaré's handwriting, but seemingly written by Louise, the wife of Poincaré, with some corrections by Poincaré himself. And so, just for showing you how the correction was done, here one example of one of the pages of the correct of the destroyed first printing and then corrected by Poincaré as the new final manuscript. Thanks so much.
Questions, comments?
35 minutes.
So they're going to destroy it? The Mittag Leffler Institute.
Well, I do not know.
I have a question to both of you about the role of algebra in your story, because it's a very strange role in both cases. We didn't expect at all algebra to come up. So can you comment about that a bit more?
Well, I don't know. I think it's a very different situation because here we had citations by Kronecker, who had a very peculiar approach to algebra, but maybe you can comment. So on the one hand, we had citations from Kronecker, who had a very specific approach to algebra. Was at the time of Poincaré in France, it was usual to think that, so you had different branches of mathematical sciences, for instance, celestial mechanics, geometry, analysis, and so on, and that algebra was what makes the links between the different branches of the mathematical sciences. So, so I don't think it's surprising to find algebra that way in Poincaré's celestial mechanics. I mean, playing this kind of role, which in a way is a structuring role, and which means that Poincaré is using methods that he has been developing or in other domains, especially function theory, for instance. And this is quite, this was very usual at the time. And in a way, it's even this circulation of methods from one branch to the other, which is sometimes considered as showing that it is actually algebraic, in a way.
Yeah, for Mittag Leffler and for Weierstrass, there was a clear divide between algebra and what they were practicing. They were calling this higher analysis, so they did not at all subscribe to this vision of Kronecker. I have
I've been lost.
Have been.
Ah, yeah.
Well, I do not know what it for Weierstrass and for Mittag Leffler, there was a clear divide between algebra on the one hand and higher analysis, which they were thinking to practice.
Yeah,
Yeah, I don't think it's very surprising. Already in the thesis of Poincaré, you have in the first lemma the proof of the Weierstrass preparation theorem, which in a sense is going from analysis to algebra, to algebraic equations. And in fact, it's a strange story because in the first version of the new method, if I remember correctly, Poincaré appeals to the theorem and he quotes his thesis and not Weierstrass. And in the meantime, the theorem had been published by Weierstrass. And I think in the thesis it's independent. Weierstrass was quoting the theorem in his lectures, but it had not been published. Also, the very thesis already of Poincaré is very algebraic in the idea of normal form. The normal form is similar to putting a matrix into normal form, and he did that for differential equation already in his thesis. So.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the Hermite's legacy, for instance, especially the theory of forms, which was which Catherine talked about this morning, is very important in Poincaré's work right from the beginning. And this kind of algebraic practices, you find them already in the thesis, but also in the works related to function functions. And at the same time that he's developing function function theory, he's publishing on algebraic forms, ternary forms, equivalence of forms, and so on. And so, in addition to that, Poincaré is also developing new algebraic methods during this time, especially by incorporating, for instance, Jordan's approaches, which are different from the ones of Hermite, and which is actually maybe one of the reasons why Hermite do not understand the whole approach of Poincaré. Because, for instance, Hermite, there's a famous letter in which Hermite says to Jordan that if he's forced to read Jordan's Traité de Substitution, then he's ready to resign from, you know, the Academy of Science. So it's a kind of algebraic method that Hermite is not using at all. So there is a Poincaré is developing some specific methods by a kind of mix of these two approaches in the early 1880s. And what is interesting is that he is using them in almost all his works, whatever it is. I mean, geometry, celestial mechanics, and so on. And for instance, there are some special methods related to what we would now nowadays designate as matrix theory or linear algebra. But of course, the tricky thing is that linear algebra does not exist as a discipline before the 1930s. And so you have different methods used by several networks of mathematicians, but also sometimes by individuals, such as, for instance, Poincaré. And Poincaré is developing some very specific methods of manipulations of the tables that Catherine showed this morning, that he's using in really all his work, and especially in the celestial mechanics. And so I think it is interesting to see how by using these kind of methods, which sometimes are quite old, for instance, in the case of the secular equations, it really comes from the 18th century, he really breaks out the mold that he has been using for making something new, which I think is related to what Catherine says this morning. There is a very, very good knowledge of what has been done before in the field, and the use of some very classical methods. But at the end, there is something new coming out of that.
Someone would like to... No? Okay, you can do a break, 10 minutes. Okay, thank you very much.